Hey, Billy Bear and Dan Haggerty here. Welcome to the Bear Haggerty Offensive on Repatriate Radio. What's up, Dan?
Hey, Billy, how are you? So what's in the news today?
Lots happening again. We'll just touch on a few things. The federal government has in the works. They're looking to seize our retirement accounts now. Big surprise there. We talked about this. They're in the process of doing that in Europe, and it's coming here. No surprise.
Now, wait a minute. I've heard about that on the Internet, but I didn't think it was going to happen. You're saying it's happening?
Well, it's in the works. There's legislation that's being proposed, and they're talking about doing this. And essentially what they're going to do is take retirement account funds and make you put them the funds into Treasury bills to fund the deficits and to just redistribute the wealth.
Okay, so let me guess. I guess cashing in our retirement funds and putting it into gold was a good idea.
Well, who knows? They'll probably come after that, too, if they need it, right? Anyway, so that's what they have in the works. I would, you could write this down. I think that they're going to do it after the stock market crashes, because at that point people will be all shaken in what they think is the private equity market, that they'll be running to the federal government to buy their treasury bonds at 1% interest or whatever it's going to be.
Yeah, I can see the ads now. We're from the government. We can help out.
So anyway, Timothy Geithner was on Bloomberg this past Friday, Bloomberg Television, and in reference to elimination of the statutory debt limit, you know, what Congress has to vote on. Anyway, his comment was regarding the elimination of it, the sooner the better. So there's obviously a move on to change the law on that, so Congress doesn't even have to vote to raise the debt ceiling, so there'll be no accountability. It'll just go up automatically, and it'll be spending for as far as the eye can see.
So you mean the illegally constituted Federal Reserve will just turn on the printing presses and not stop?
It seems to be the option.
It's funny they did that in Germany and didn't work.
Well, I guess it depends on how you define work.
Yeah.
Anyway, the fiscal cliff that everybody's talking about is basically when the automatic deficit reduction, or ostensibly what they say is the deficit reduction, goes into place if alternatives can't be reached, and it's composed almost exclusively of tax increases. About 2% is supposedly spending cuts, but the spending cuts are really not spending cuts. They're a reduction in the increase of spending.
A reduction in the rate of increase.
That's
in
right.
Other words,
right?
Like for example, as Carl Denninger says, if I expected to put on 40 pounds this holiday season, and I only put on 20 pounds, I can call that a decrease in my weight, right?
Well, yeah, right, you lost 20 pounds.
Yeah, okay.
So that's kind of, we know in Washington, that's what they call a spending decrease, is when they decrease the rate of increase.
My God, do these people ever tell the truth?
So that's some of what's going on. Something's going on in Texas, though. I read a story about a student in Texas. It seemed pretty disturbing.
Well, I tell you, I can fill you in on that. And this is going on. A student in a Texas school district has been told she is to be expelled for refusing to wear a student ID badge that essentially places her in an electronic concentration camp. Regimes in the past have always started with the schools, where they develop a compliant citizenry, John Whitehead, president of the Rutherford Institute, said. They're getting students used to living in a total surveillance state where there will be no privacy wherever you go, and whatever you text or email will be watched by the government. This is where everything is headed. The primary intent of these tracking cards is not to increase student safety, as they say, but to increase state funding to the district. That's really what it's about. WOAI-TV in San Antonio reported district spokesman Pascual Gonzalez said the two schools have a high rate of truancy, and the district could gain $2 million in state funding by approving attendance. Despite the schools having 295 surveillance cameras, officials apparently believe that's not enough to keep track of students attending the school. After her refusal to wear the tracking chip, Hernandez was warned in a letter that there would, quote, be consequences. Uh-oh. Following through on its threats, the district sent Hernandez a letter informing her she would be expelled effective November 26th. There you have it. I'll tell you, that's just outrageous on so many levels. I don't know where to begin. But,
well, it's interesting. That story is just the type of so many other stories that we can cover in this time. But it's going on throughout our whole society, basically the government invading everything they can invade at this point. So our guest should have a very interesting perspective on this, don't you think?
Oh, absolutely. Our guest was a speechwriter and special assistant for special projects to retired Congressman Jack Metcalf. He has been a consultant to federal law enforcement, Homeland Security for over 25 years and has written four books on international relations and philosophy. His latest book is The Hydra of Carnage, Bush's Imperial Warmaking and the Rule of Law. Hulet himself served as a soldier in Vietnam in 1969 through 1970 in the 101st Airborne and graduated third in his class at the Aberdeen Proving Grounds Ordnance School as a weapons specialist. He remains a paid analyst and consultant in various areas of geopolitical, business, and security issues, terrorism, and military affairs. Welcome, Craig Hulet. How are you today?
Good afternoon.
Hey, Craig, great to have you on the show.
Okay,
so,
thanks.
Craig, where's the Republic right now? Where are we headed? And we'll get down to more specifics, but what's your overview of what's going on here?
I wasn't expecting that question, but I can certainly give you an answer. I think America, as the America that we've become accustomed to, the America that we've thought we are part of, I think it's pretty much over. I think before anything, I used to say when things are going to get much worse before they get better, I'm afraid now at this point I say things are going to get very much worse. I don't think things are going to get better. I think they're just going to get worse in every aspect of our life.
So as a friend of ours says, that sounds like you don't have your positive pants on.
You know, if I wasn't somewhat of a positivist or optimist, I don't believe in hope. I'll admit that to you. I'm a Nietzschean, so I foreclosed on the idea of hope a long time ago. Hope's not a plan of action.
I guess you're not too big on change either when it's linked with hope, huh?
Well, the change would have to come from the American people, and I don't see the American people. You know, I've been doing the public forum over 15,000 hours of radio and television for 35 years. 35 years ago, there was a huge turnout of interest, both radio lectures I would give. I could get 2,000 people to come to a lecture in Los Angeles after only doing three radio interviews. Now I'm afraid those days are gone. The American people are, as Bill Maher has stated, they are selling their souls on the altar of entertainment. I'm afraid you and I and your partner in crime over there, we're not very entertaining any longer.
Well, you know, that's bizarre, because what you just said about having a hard time getting crowds out to listen to what you're saying, many sectors of our society, including organizations that Dan and I are involved with, Tea Parties and similar grassroots-type groups, conservative, libertarian, constitutional, whatever, it seems like the storyline is that more and more people are more and more involved than ever, and you're telling us exactly the opposite, which kind of confirms to me, Dan, why we've had a hard time putting things together.
Well, I think Craig is reflecting what happened in the last election, too. Craig,
I think, you know, the country has never been as divided as it is at this point. And the elections, I don't believe, are a good tell of the sense of it that I get that's out there in the public forum. We're being driven into two camps. One is a false liberal camp, which supposedly would be represented by Obama, which is foolish to think that way. And then there's the conservative or Republican camp, which would have been represented by Romney. The fact of the matter is, and I use this language now quite often, I only deal with the things that matter. I only deal with things that affect the vast majority of the American people. And I know things like abortion, gun ownership, the right to keep and bear. These things are important. Of course they are. But they're not the issues that the government is concerned with. The government is interested in, for instance, what the Federal Reserve does, what the banking industry is doing. It cares about foreign and domestic policy, the surveillance state, the drone wars. And when you look at those things, what the government is doing in the area of things that matter, the American people really don't care. They care more about, you know, who cares if gays can get married? I don't even think most gay men could give a damn whether they or have the right to get married or not. Yet this is what's the driving force behind our politics, because nobody wants to talk about, for instance, the $29 trillion the Levy Institute has documented the Federal Reserve has stolen from the American people without congressional approval, dispersed the funds worldwide to the richest banks and corporations, which have then placed it into brand new tax havens, and completely unbeknownst to the American people, no one's discussing it. It was not discussed during the debates. In fact, that issue was hands-off, as was the drone wars. So, on the things that matter, the American people not only are not hearing anything about the things that matter, I don't believe they want to any longer.
So, Craig, now that you brought it up, we figured we'd come in, we'd get into this topic somewhere in the show, but you mentioned these trillions of dollars. What do you know about this? Dan and I covered it. I don't think it was covered anywhere when we covered it. The story had just come out. This $43 trillion, that's with a T, it's $43 trillion lawsuit that's being brought by the Spire Group, a law firm in New York, against effectively the many in the federal government, the Federal Reserve, the enormous banks. What do you know about that? And do you have any information on the connection with the death of the children in New York by the nanny, supposedly, about a month or so ago? What do you know about that?
Well, I was the first one to report on it on a morning show right after it took place, both the murder of the two children and the nanny being severely wounded, with in its correspondence to the fact that first the Wall Street Journal issued the press release of the Spire Law Group's lawsuit. It is a legitimate lawsuit. There's a lot of garbage out there on the Internet that this lawsuit is a hoax. I've already spoken to a number of the lawyers, one of the lawyers from the Spire Law Group, and I got together this past weekend. We will be going forward, and hopefully I'll get one of those lawyers to come on your show, if you'd be...
Would be great. It's interesting you say that about it being a real lawsuit, because when we first covered the story, which was probably right around when you came out with it, my refrain was, it's a real lawsuit, it's a real law firm, these children really got killed, that it was all real. I said, we're not sure positively of the connections here, but all the things I was stating were facts as being real, and you're basically corroborating that by what you're saying about actually speaking to the lawyer. That'd be great if we can get somebody from that firm on the show. That'd be cool.
Okay, yeah. Well, the state of the complaint right now, I had my lawyer take a look at it. The complaint was originally filed in New York State Court, or what they call a Supreme Court, which is a trial-level court in New York. It's like a superior court in California or Washington.
Right,
State.
It's the lower level. It's the trial division.
Okay, the suit was removed from the U.S. District Court for the Eastern District of New York, Brooklyn. This is typical when the plaintiff and the defendant satisfy the diversity of citizenship rule and the amount in controversy exceeds $75,000. Now, at least some of the defendants have been served and have requested extensions of time to respond, and that's pretty typical, according to my guy. Responses to the complaint would typically, include challenges to jurisdiction, which they have. A judge issued an order on November 9th in which at least one defendant, I think it was Bank of America, had a motion to transfer the venue to the Central District of California. So it's moving through the courts exactly as it's supposed to. The next step, which is, this is a difficult one, and this will be the real test of it, eventually there'll be a motion to dismiss by the defendants.
Right.
If both parties get past those motions to dismiss, then the case will move forward. But this is the critical point, is that Bank of America, Chase, people that are named in the lawsuit, like Eric Holder, Timothy Geithner, Robert Rubin, are actually named as individuals in this lawsuit. Now, they're all going to try to get it dismissed, which is, of course, the reason why Eric Holder had planned to resign, but the Obama administration has instructed him, we're not going to accept your resignation for at least a year, and it's not for any of the reasons they're saying. I know that the reason is that right now, while this lawsuit is working its way through the courts, they want to be able to protect Eric Holder by the White House. The White House will
kind of
throw up a block
information or something, like national security reasons or something like that.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, Craig, a question for you.
I talked to an attorney, I have a family member who's an attorney, and their first reaction was they said, well, this lawsuit's bogus because it's filed in the Eastern District in Brooklyn, and none of these companies reside there, so it's irrelevant. And the first four pages are filled with people's names from all over the country. So yeah, I guess that point has no validity that this person said?
No, it doesn't, because what they're doing is this is a class action suit that's nationwide. They have lawyers in all the states in question that are filing, and subpoenas are going out from all the different districts and all the different courts. This is going to be a very widespread lawsuit, and it's going to test Mitchell Stein and James Fielder and the other lawyers, including the one I spoke with. It's going to really stretch their resources. What they're trying to do with this, the idea that this is a bogus lawsuit, is to stop Spire Law Group from adding additional plaintiffs to the lawsuit on an ongoing basis. In other words, you could call them today. If you're having trouble with Bank of America and you've been defrauded in the loan department and you're being foreclosed on, you can contact the Spire Law Group. Doesn't matter where you live or what state you reside, because these corporations operate across state lines. Countrywide is being sued right now. Countrywide is the one that Bank of America absorbed, but they're being separately pursued by different AGs, attorney generals in different states. So this is nationwide. This isn't focused in one small area. So
okay, you know, so it doesn't matter which federal court they filed it in, really.
No, because it's going to be each case will be transferred to whatever district the venue is granted by the judge. And it seems the judge has already granted it in one case to the Central District of California. My guess is that's Bank of America.
Well, really, the bottom line here is, at least, is it going to enter into a discovery phase, which obviously when that happens, if the media even cares to cover a $43 trillion lawsuit, that's when it's going to get very interesting. If it gets that far, it's going to keep going.
This is why I got involved. When I first heard about the lawsuit, this dovetailed with exactly the work I've been doing for two decades on the trillions of dollars the Federal Reserve and the Treasury has moved offshore, either through loans, assets, purchases, however they're doing it, doesn't matter. But all the multitude of ways they've been doing it, the Levy Institute has documented that they have transferred over $29 trillion. Well, let me read it to you, okay? This is from the Levy Institute's discussion of all the files that were garnered in a Freedom of Information Act through Bloomberg. Bloomberg filed it. Well, the documents they got were so overwhelming, they brought the Levy Institute, a very well-respected institution, economic analysis, and they took a hold of it. This is just one statement in their 36-page first report. They're doing a report each month. It says the extraordinary scope and magnitude of the recent financial crisis of 2007 and 2009 required an extraordinary response by the Fed in the fulfillment of its lender of last resort function. The Fed's response did not disappoint. It was truly extraordinary. The purpose of this paper is to provide a descriptive account of the Fed's response to the recent financial crisis. In an attempt to stabilize financial markets during the worst financial crisis since the Great Crash, the Fed engaged in loans, guarantees, outright purchases of financial assets that were not only unprecedented, and here's the rub, and of questionable legality, but cumulatively amounted to over twice the U.S. gross domestic product, $29 trillion.
Well, this is going to, I mean, unfortunately, most people, or many people, are going to see this as something that's so enormous that they're not even going to believe it's for real. I mean, and probably you had the same reaction, when you first saw a lawsuit that was suing for $43 trillion, you were like, it's got to be a joke. I mean, the first thing I do is I Googled the Spire Law Group, and I saw the everything right there, like you probably did,
yeah.
And I read the whole thing, and I read the complaint, and I'm like, this is for real. I saw the docket number and everything else.
Yeah, there's four pages of defendants. The first four pages list one name after another. The other thing, Craig, my contact said was, well, this isn't going to go anywhere. It'll get thrown out of court. These people are too big to allow this to happen.
Well, I can assure you that that's probably what they're going to attempt to do. There's no question they're going to try to get to Jack Weinstein, the judge, and have him dismiss the case. That's a real possibility. But after discussing this with the lawyer at Spire Law Group and the decision to get me involved in getting them the kind of publicity necessary to get this case heard. I told the lawyer, I'm going to stay with this, well, until I die, unless something stops it in a way that I can't foresee. They will refile this lawsuit over and over and over again. Even if it's called a frivolous lawsuit and they throw it out of court, it'll simply be rebuilt and these guys will start all over. They're not going to quit because they happen to be correct. And the reason we know they're correct is that the attorney generals in almost a dozen states, including the Manhattan U.S. attorney, is suing the Bank of America for over $1 billion for multi-year mortgage fraud that they committed against Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. And this is happening in every state in the union. And it, by the way, as far as the two children, let's make sure, I don't want to lose sight of something. When it first came out, somebody reacted to it very viciously, and CNBC posted the press release of the lawsuit on CNBC's website. 2 hours later, it was removed, and 2 hours later, the children of the executive, Kenneth Krim, were dead. He found out that his children had been killed, and the nanny, who supposedly slit her wrist and slit her throat, had done the deed. But nobody knows the time frame, because it was within 2 hours of it being posted, taken down, and the kids were dead. Did he take it down after he found out the kids were dead? That's the area where nobody's talking.
Right,
but
yeah,
I don't
actually
believe for a second that the nanny did it. First of all, I've got military background. I teach edged weapons and martial arts to my client base, and I can assure you, nobody can individually inflict that kind of wound on themselves. She stabbed herself in the throat, turned the knife with enough strength that it broke her vertebrae, broke her neck. Now, okay, I could do this by coming up behind somebody as a trained operative, but she could never have done this to herself. It's absolutely unheard of, and it's ridiculous to think the nanny did it. But the
Craig,
nanny,
Craig, it sounds like you hear these accounts of they find a person hanging from a tree with their wrists tied together, they've been shot and burned, and they call it a suicide.
Exactly. I also use Vincent Foster as an example in a recent show. He's supposed to have shot himself in the head, yet he still had the pistol in a firm grip in his right hand. It's absurd. There's no question these are homicides. But more than that, I have one of my colleagues looking into it, and we've discovered that in a separate case, the United States District Court, Eastern District of New York, versus Gregory Mackler. Gregory Mackler was a whistleblower. Again, this is against Bank of America, and when I say Bank of America, that includes Mellon Bank, Countryside, all of the et al's that come with a lawsuit. But
no,
Gregory Mackler is now in witness protection custody, so he can testify, or he would be dead. Although
the station in Vegas
reported that Tracy Lawrence was found dead after she agreed to turn state's evidence against Bank of America.
Wow.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, well, when we talked about this story a month or so ago, we discussed the details like you are, not the same, but similar. And what we weren't positive about was exactly what you identified, the time frame. I mean, it sounded like at that point that the time frame was that the story was posted on CNBC, was aired on Squawk Box, a CNBC television station, and the children were killed, and then the story was taken down. But you're saying it's not clear what the chronology was, but it's
well,
certainly,
even if the story was taken down and then the children were killed, then it would be a simple measure of they're sending a message. You have to understand, Kevin Krim isn't just who you think he is. If people had bothered to do a little bit of homework and look into this properly, you'd discover that he worked for J.P. Morgan Chase for 3 months as a strategic analyst and giving them the strategies to fight the lawsuits that were coming down against J.P. Morgan Chase for foreclosure fraud. So he has intimate knowledge of the things that are going on where the criminal prosecutions are going after these very banks that are named in the Spire lawsuit. He was actually there for 3 months, and from January, the first of this year, for 3 months, helping J.P. Morgan Chase create a strategy to defend themselves against the fraud and foreclosure criminal charges.
Wow.
I've been a consultant of federal law enforcement for over 25 years. When somebody gets murdered or a house gets burglarized and you discovered that there's a connection between a bank and the murder, or the bank and the loan officer whose home is burglarized, every cop says the same thing. There are no such things as coincidence in those kinds of areas.
No, I wouldn't think so.
Like in politics, there's no such thing as a coincidence.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, this is right out of a Hollywood movie. I mean, it's unbelievable. Craig, do you know anything about the condition of the woman now? Is she conscious? The nanny?
Yes.
Are they preventing her from speaking to people or what?
No, she's been instructed not to speak to anybody by her lawyer. He was there when she awakened, when she came out of the coma. The lawyer was already present. The first thing the nanny asked is my family okay? Her family.
Right. Now, why would a suicide victim think that?
Obviously, before she was placed into the coma, she assumed her family was at risk, or that wouldn't be the first thing that came out of her mouth. Now, they've silenced her because I think everybody's aware. Oh, by the way, my understanding, and this is the only thing I've not been able to verify because nobody's talking. Absolutely, not even the father or the mother. Nobody's talking. And then if you want to ask why, would you? If
exactly.
somebody just
and
killed
Craig,
your children under a threat that you were going to speak out, would you now speak out?
Craig, no. We're coming up against a break. It's half past the hour. We're at WNJC 1360 AM on the Bear Haggerty Offensive of Repatriate Radio. We're listening to Craig Hulet, and we're discussing the Spire lawsuit, an enormous lawsuit. The tab is $43 trillion. And, Craig, you reminded me of another issue. We live very close to, and we're pretty good friends of Jerome Corsi. Do you know Dr. Corsi?
I've heard of him.
Sure. He uncovered a similar scam, apparently, at HSBC last summer. He reported on it, and immediately the next day he was fired from his part-time position as a financial analyst with a New York finance company.
Yeah, it's interesting because we spoke to him about it, and he thought he was going to get like a promotion or something, and he got fired.
Yeah. Well, it turns out there was a whistleblower at HSBC who said, I'm finding all these billion-dollar payments to these shadowy companies. And he went out and tried to track down the companies. In one case, he went to a house, a single-family home in Queens. An Asian gentleman answered the door, couldn't speak English, didn't know what was going on. And this was allegedly the office of a multi-billion-dollar corporation. So apparently there's some kind of scam been going on.
Interestingly,
money laundering.
Those payments all went through the wire system, which goes through Fed Wire, the Federal Reserve wire system, and there you would think there'd be records of those.
Yeah, it's so Craig, this sounds very similar.
I was contacted right after I did my first interview, and the Examiner.com did a story about my second interview on Coast to Coast on this subject, and Bill Bergman contacted me. He was with the Federal Reserve Bank in Chicago as an economist and a market analyst. He discovered exactly the same thing pre-2001, prior to 9/11, during July and August. He saw an anomalous amount of $100 bills leaving the Federal Reserve through exactly the wire service you're discussing. He did his investigation. He did due diligence. He thought, again, he would bring about an investigation and he would get promoted. He also was fired.
Oh, boy. I'll tell you, and I read the first part of the complaint on the Spire lawsuit, and it said that this has been going on since 2001, but it's accelerated tremendously since 2008. So this has been going on a long time.
This has been going on a long time. And I don't think this is something that we should look at as, you know, just the criminal side to it. This kind of a thing never happens. Like FDR said, nothing happens in government by accident.
Right.
So this is going on with the full approval of two separate administrations. The Bush administration, which began it when the TARP funds first started. I refer to it as the greatest theft in galactic history. Unfortunately, the only person that quoted me on that was Oliver Stone, not crediting me, of course, but Bill Maher. But administrations, thousands of people that stay in each administration, regardless of who's the Treasury Secretary today, the people below him, they're there for each administration. So I cannot believe this is happening without the full knowledge and consent of the White House and the senior members of both houses.
And the people who really control our government. That's
and you can't believe this is happening in a vacuum. It's not possible. Not to mention, like I said, people are dying.
People are being murdered. It's happened before with other administrations. There have been murders. This is not a surprise anymore. Can I ask you, how did you get involved in this? Because from your curricula vitae, you're an author, you're a consultant, things like that. But from what you're saying now, you've latched onto this case in a very big way. Why are you doing that? And what's the nature of your involvement?
Well, the nature of my involvement is going to be to see that this gets as much publicity and it gets out in the open in such a way that they will stop killing people, A. B, it'll hold up in court and be pursued to its end result. And the reason is I've been doing this for 30 years. I've never not in my lifetime discussed the Federal Reserve System and the banking system because I was in the corporate world. I had clients like Weyerhaeuser, U.S. Home, Exxon, Friendship Development, and I saw the corruption firsthand as a consultant and analyst in the corporate world. I started doing things in the public realm and working with law enforcement. In fact, I'm working on an embezzlement case right now with a California corporation. The CEO was one of my clients. His company, I knew there was something wrong in his corporation. I approached him and suggested we do an internal audit and take a look at it and find out where the bleeder was. I uncovered an embezzler, probably $1.5 million, maybe $2 million. The company was on the ropes. I've set the company back on its feet as a fixer, but I'm doing this in the private sector. I'm the president and CFO of that company, and I'm the president and COO of another company. That doesn't mean that I can't operate in the public realm, and I don't need to be paid. As you know, you don't get paid for doing interviews. I don't get paid for any of this. I'm doing it because I have children and grandchildren, so do most of us. This country will not survive the next 20 years unless something is drastically done to stop this.
Well, Craig,
it's not going to make it.
Give us an overview of what is going on in the, let's say, whether it's the country or, I guess, the world, what's going on globally compared to what people perceive as the structure of things and the nature of things.
Oh, okay. Well, that's, okay, perfect question. This isn't even about the United States. The United States of America doesn't even exist the way it existed 35 years ago when I first broke into the corporate world. When I left the military, I was destined for national security and corporate boardrooms. That was my dream. That's where my direction was. The country's not even the same place anymore. The globalization process, the technology, there's a new global regime that exists. It's not a conspiracy, and it never was a conspiracy. You would have known about it if you'd been in the boardroom of Exxon. You would have seen what the plan was afoot, and that is to go global. The marketplace is the Wild West. It's China. It's Asia. That's where they want to sell cars and refrigerators and build highways. That's where you sell homes to the Chinese. You can later foreclose on them as well later. But, that's the new marketplace. It's a global regime of economic interdependence, and it has no relationship, none whatsoever, to the United States of America. America is just a cog in the wheel. So every leftist, like Noam Chomsky and, Basevich, they all say the American empire is in decline. No, it's not. The empire is doing very well indeed. They just took $43 trillion from the American people, put it in their own bank accounts overseas in tax havens, and you ain't going to get that money back. So who's benefiting?
The global empire
is benefiting, and it has nothing to do with America.
So what we see with our government and our politicians and our different institutions, is this almost like a facade, or what do these entities do?
Well, the entities still exist here domestically to control the domestic population, but they have no relationship to the global regime that's being created. That's a corporate regime, and that's a separate governing entity, no different than a government anywhere else. That's why we have separate entities like NATO, the World Bank, the IMF, the Bank for International Development. Those are separate governing entities of a global regime that has only to do with one thing, and that's the corporate structure, the monopoly multinational corporate structure. You and I aren't playing in that league. We're blue and white-collar workers domestically. These guys are gold-collar workers globally.
So does
they
that
have no interest in America.
Right, does that corporate structure and that corporate elite, do they, in a sense, then do they dictate to our government what's going on? I mean, are they...
They are our government.
Right?
They are our government.
You're talking about the Council of Foreign Relations and the Bilderbergs and the trilateral...
Well, you don't even have to go that direction. I mean, obviously, those entities exist, and why wouldn't they exist? The same reason why, you know, Bob and Harvey, you know, join the Screen Actors Guild, and the way, you know, mom and pop shops become part of the Chamber of Commerce. But those entities don't mean anything when you look at who the men are. They are the same men. It isn't a coincidence that Timothy Geithner and Robert Rubin are both named in this $43 trillion lawsuit as having gained from the theft and the mortgage foreclosures and the defrauding of the American taxpayers. It's not a coincidence that both these men also worked at Goldman Sachs. They also, you know, they revolve in and out of our government. Now, whether they're a member of a group or not is irrelevant to me. It's who they are as individuals. When Dick Cheney works in our government and then leaves and goes to work at Halliburton, he is the government, whether he's at Halliburton or Secretary of State. That's who's governing this country. And we're being governed no differently than Guatemala or Ecuador.
So is this, like, how does this, if it is this distinct from fascism, or is this fascism? I mean, what are we seeing here?
I call it corporatism. That word translated into Italian is corporazzone.
Right.
So corporazzone, corporatism, you know, you can't question the economic aspects of fascism, because you have to be careful. Then the people think you're calling these guys Nazis. They're not Nazis, but they're corporatists. And they believe that government and the largest corporations should work hand in hand. They hate free enterprise.
So you're saying free enterprise. Yeah, they don't want competition.
Their job is to get rid of competition.
Right, right. And you see that in the pharmaceutical industry and a lot of industries in the U.S.
Every major industry that matters is being centralized.
So to use the word fascist, even though it's technically correct, it misses the point because it diverts people.
Well, conjures up a different approach.
Yeah, it conjures up the wrong image.
Well, Mussolini said that fascism should more accurately be called corporatism.
Yeah,
that
correct.
That is the way it's played out.
Right.
Well,
so,
if you look at the textbook on fascism by Mario Palmieri, the textbook has absolutely nothing to do with the politics of Nazi Germany or even the politics of Italy at the time. Mario Palmieri was the brains behind Mussolini. And in his book, he describes nothing short of the United States of America's multinational corporations forming organizations through the use of government entities to create organizations to control that industry, any particular industry that matters. Now, they don't care about, you know, Bob and Harvey that are selling Twinkies on a street corner. They care about oil, natural resources, electricity, water.
Yeah.
The next wars will be fought over water. Monsanto is buying up North Africa.
So what role do you see our government or governments playing in terms of representing the interests of the people?
They haven't represented the interests of the people in five decades. They represent the interests of the corporate elite that believe they have the best and the brightest, that they can take humanity down the road of prosperity, that we have to. And in that belief system, they firmly believe that poverty and hunger is a natural state of affairs. There's going to be people that are going hungry because they're not part of the system of buy and sell in a monopoly corporate system. Archer Daniels Midland's CEO said exactly that when they asked him, look, Dwayne Andreas, can't you feed the world? You're Archer Daniels Midland. Can't you feed the world? He said, of course we can. But they don't have any money.
So just two questions. Number one, very briefly, we have about 17 minutes. Very briefly, what do our representatives and our senators, do they know they're part of this, or are they just useful idiots? I mean, what role do they play, generally speaking?
Most of them, in a general sense, they know something very powerful is afoot, and they go along with it because they really don't have any power anyways. There's a few at the highest levels of the Senate and the House leadership. They know exactly what's going along, and they've sold out long ago. Now, a freshman senator or congressman like Obama, he doesn't know squat. That's why when he stumbled into the White House and landed on his feet and he took his oath, he looked like he was scared to death. I thought the poor guy was going to turn white. That's because he got an education. You're not the president. This is the way the world works. It does not work the way you think, brother.
So who is Obama, then? Is he just some
Obama
guy
is just, he's no different
House?
Than George Bush Jr., except George Bush Jr. went into it heads up knowing that the president is a puppet. Obama went into the presidency like Reagan, thinking, I'm actually going to be able to do something for the people.
All right,
that's the only difference. But in any case, you're a puppet. The only time we haven't had a real, genuine puppet in the White House was George Bush Sr.
Oh, that's interesting.
Really?
Well, explain that a little bit.
Is
that because he's pulling the strings on all the other puppets?
No, it's because he's connected with Zapata Oil. He was CIA director. He was ambassador to China. He was ambassador to the United Nations. His family goes back to Brown Brothers Harriman. They were in the banking industry. He sold Zapata Oil for $2.5 billion when he left the White House. So, you know, he always has been a player. But when I say that, these guys are probably more liberal, less racist, and bigoted than anybody on the planet. They don't care who you are or where you're from. This is about one thing and one thing only: money.
Okay,
money is power.
So, all right. So, Craig, 50 years this has been going on. None of the politicians have tried to do anything about it. And you mentioned Oliver Stone before. That brings me to the obvious question. John Kennedy, was he trying to do something about it, and that's why the powers that be took him out? What do you think about that?
Well, let me put it this way. Oliver Stone and I have been friends for 30 years. Every time I go to Los Angeles, I have a standing invite to have dinner with him. Now, Oliver Stone's not going to admit that he's friends with me, although he has written some nice things that I put on my website. He's made some nice comments. He's contacted Larry King. But the truth of the matter is, I'm so dangerous to Hollywood that nobody really wants to be in the room with me. Nobody wants to work with me on a movie. And frankly, I don't want to, because another movie like JFK isn't going to help us. We need real people, real politicians, real politics with feet on the ground. We need muddy boots on the ground at this point. The country has been taken from us. $43 trillion is almost three times the gross domestic product of the United States. It's twice the domestic product of Europe. There's no comparison when you talk about this much money. And I want to say something before this goes off the air. One host challenged me and said, it's $43 trillion of fiat currency that this Spire Law Group is trying to get returned. That money's worthless. I said, no, it's not. It is not worthless. That $43 trillion is exactly worth whatever it can buy in this day's marketplace. And Spire Law Group wisely stated why they've done this. Why this has happened is stated in this lawsuit. Does anybody recall
it? What did they say?
Land.
Yes, real property.
Land. Now, he's not talking about the foreclosed homes. He's talking like Monsanto buying up the entire North African continent so they could grow crops. How do they get the crops to market? They need a deep water port. How do you get a deep water port? You remove Gaddafi from Libya.
Exactly. So, Craig, most people, most Americans, they're not going to untangle all this. And, I mean, most people are concerned, well, how does this affect me? Now, what do you see coming going forward? And how is this going to affect the average American? Basically, if people are living okay and they have some liberties and they have some money and they're doing whatever they're doing, they're okay. How is what everything you're talking about going to affect our society and our culture and our population.
Well, truthfully, they're not okay. They're living on debt. Most of them are living on debt. 90 million Americans are permanently unemployed, and they never will be employed again. The few that are left that are employed, they live on credit cards and debt. Without the debt structure of the banking system, they wouldn't have anything. So the future is pretty bleak when this thing runs its course. More people are going to face permanent unemployment. Welfare state's going to grow, but the benefits are going to be much less, and inflation's going to be absolutely incredible. The cost of goods and services is going to go through the roof.
It already is now. Have you been shopping lately?
But as long as you've got credit cards and debt, you don't notice it that much. But, you know, people generally, I believe, they're getting scared. I think they're seeing that something's really, really wrong, and it is affecting the average household.
So, but people would ask, how is it to the corporation's benefit if they're basically impoverishing their customer base?
Well, it's not their customer base. Their customer base is global.
Yeah. So basically, the United States is being sacrificed to build up India and China. And
now you're getting it.
Yeah.
Yes,
yeah,
America is being sacrificed on the land, on the altar of globalization and spreading the new order of loans and homes and refrigerators to the third world and the developing world. People that haven't got cars and highways, that's the new world. That's where the money's to be made.
Well, on the face of it, that sounds okay. Let's help out the third world. Let's lift them up to our level so we're on a...
Well, we're not doing it willingly. We're being tricked into it. It sounds...
Well, exactly. But is that not a laudable motivation, Craig, for some people?
Sure. It would be a laudable motivation if it was led by Gandhi and Mother Teresa, but it's not. It's being led by people like Geithner and Bernanke, and they could give a damn about the rest of the world. Their interest is in their global community, their friends, their colleagues. It's no different than the Roman Senate. They didn't care about the Roman people. That's why the idea that this is an American empire has to be silenced. Noam Chomsky is wrong. I've been saying this for 30 years. The guy's got it wrong. This has got nothing to do with America. If it was an American empire, the American people would benefit.
Well, I guess people would argue
it's
that we have benefited.
It's a global empire.
So General Electric is not an American company anymore. It's a global company, and that's why they're moving their factories from the U.S. to China. So they increase their bottom line.
Exactly. Well, that's also why did Halliburton move to Bahrain? Boeing's moving to China. Their headquarters will be in China in the next 10 years. They already left Seattle. They moved to Chicago.
So Craig, what do you see the landscape looking like in the United States in the next, whether it's a year or two or 5 years out, or what do you see things looking like here, economically, socially, politically? What's going to happen?
Well, it's going to feel like socialism, but it'll be called democracy. The poor will stay poor, and the rich will get rich, and the high technology of surveillance, drones, facial recognition. Have you ever seen the movie Blade Runner?
Sure.
That's kind of what it's going to look like, I'm afraid.
And is there anything we could do about? I mean, to me, the biggest concern is the loss of liberty, even more so than... I mean, it's hard to separate the loss of liberty and the loss of property. It's kind of the same thing, really. But that's really my biggest concern, is the invasiveness of the government on every level.
Well, you know, the facial recognition, the invasion of privacy, the lack of privacy, you know... That concerns me, it concerns my son, but will it concern my grandchildren? Most of the youth I see, they're just happy as clams with Facebook. They all think they're celebrities. And the more you know about, you know, peeking under their skirts, the happier they seem to be.
Boy, that's pretty grim. Now, Billy had just said, what can we do? Now, it sounds like you're on a personal mission about this Spire lawsuit, and I love to hear that. I contacted the Spire lawsuit through an open portal on their website asking for comments, and I said, listen, I'd like to find out more about this lawsuit. I host a radio show. Craig, I'll tell you, this is a very interesting topic to us and to our listeners. We've gotten a lot of feedback on that since we mentioned it on one of our prior shows. Is there any way that you could get someone from Spire to come on the show with us and help?
I intend to do just that. Every host, every producer that is putting me on the air on this subject, I just talked to one. I did a live studio interview. This is the second one. He was the first one I put the story out. It's in Washington State. He's going to put... All I have to do is... I've got to get together with Spire Law Group's lawyers and construct a strategy on how to go forward with this. But, you know, I know that Mitchell Stein would be more than happy to do it. By the way, I'm going to predict he'll be rebarred in California in less than 6 months.
Hmm. Wow.
He was disbarred, and that's one of the things that they claim that, you know, he's a fraud and he's a huckster. He was attacked by the California Attorney General for filing exactly this lawsuit at the California state level previously in 2010. That's why they went after him and threw his name into a pot of lawyers that were defrauding the public. They were just punishing him for naming the Attorney General and the banking system in California. That was retribution. But this guy's resilient. This guy's the real thing. He's not afraid of them. He's not going anywhere. Neither am I.
Well, Craig, let me ask you. I'm reading the Spire Group's website. This is obviously pro bono work, and they do a lot of pro bono. Where are they going to get the resources to pursue this?
If they get an award, I don't think it's going to be. It's not.
Well, no.
Contingents on the contingent.
Oh, it's probably contingent, but. You know, to take depositions, all the costs involved, where are they going to get the resources for that?
Well, you know, I'll let one of the... I just got off the phone Saturday with one of the lawyers who's listening to this show as we speak. He's monitoring all the shows, as is probably Mitchell Stein. I'll let them answer that question. But, you know, they have the means. These guys are pretty high-powered lawyers. They have enough personal income that I think they can satisfy their livelihood. This is a creed that, you know, Mitchell Stein personally has, that nobody should be defrauded and corruption shouldn't be answered. And corruption at this level must be answered.
Well, Craig, just so you know, I'm an attorney. I don't know if we mentioned that. I don't know if Dan mentioned in the emails or anything, but I'm an attorney, number one. Number two, Dan and I live a half hour from Manhattan. The Spire Group has offices in Manhattan, too, don't they?
Yes. You know, one of the things they're doing right now is I think they're lying low and letting this work its way through the court. I don't think they really want to disrupt the process of going through the court system, but they are gaining new plaintiffs in the case every day. People are hearing about this. Other lawyers are referring their clients that have been foreclosed on fraudulently, and they're sending them to Spire Law Group. Right now, the lawyer I talk to is taking depositions. But, you know, as far as I can tell, nobody's going to back off on this, ever.
It sounds like that story I heard, I forget where it was, but the plaintiff who had been foreclosed convinced the judge that Bank of America did this erroneously, and the judge ordered the sheriff to go to the nearest B of A and pull the money out of the drawers, literally. So, God help us. Hopefully we get a judge like that. So you're saying these guys are old-style lawyers. They really are in it for justice, truth, and liberty.
And the American way.
And the old American way.
You know, years ago, I have a friend that's a lawyer that is also one of my clients, and I've told him a dozen times, if there was any way I could have been born differently in this world, I would have loved to have gone to Yale University, got a law degree, and I would be doing exactly what I'm doing with you right now on the telephone, on this radio show, except I would be doing Jerry Spence all over the courtroom.
Right.
Okay,
it's
so...
the only thing that can stop these people is the law.
Well, I mean, my concern, having been involved with various aspects of the law and politics for the past 4 years, is that the system seems so corrupt that, you know, the idea of it just getting dismissed, yeah, legally it might be the totally wrong thing to do. They're not going to have any basis to dismiss it. You're going to have a lawsuit potentially with hundreds of thousands of plaintiffs in this class. Yet the judges just seem to do what they want for any reason, for no reason at all. And what's the recourse? To go to the next level? And then what happens?
Okay, well, here's the reason to do it. Let me give you the best reason in the world to do it. Have I got 5 minutes?
No, you have about 2 minutes.
Yeah,
okay. Let me put it this way. In A year ago, there was a lawsuit filed by Lloyd's of London to collect $280 million from the royal family of Saudi Arabia for being behind 9/11. They were collecting the money because all the money had gone out as an insurance company to play the claims of the passengers' families on the planes that were taken down in 9/11. That lawsuit was filed on a Sunday. I picked it up on Monday, went public with it on 10 radio stations. By Thursday, the Saudi royal family paid the lawsuit. They settled out of court, and by Friday, Obama was standing next to the Saudi prince saying, "We have a special relationship with Saudi Arabia." But that doesn't change the fact that I have the entire lawsuit posted on my website for anybody to see that makes it perfectly clear that the Saudi Arabian government was behind 9/11.
Quickly, Craig, what's that website for our audience?
www.craigbhulett, H-U-L-E-T.
CraigBHulett.com. Last quick question, and then we have to close it out. What do people do? What's the 30 seconds? What do people do?
Go there, read everything on my website, and make a really, really good decision on your own self-interest.
Okay. Once more, Craig, the website for our audience.
CraigBHulett.com. It's CraigHulett. Craig B, as in Bravo, Hulett.com.
Okay, hey, great having you on.
Craig, thanks a lot.
We'll be in touch with you.
All right. Stay angry.
All right. Beautiful. Thank you. Hey, it's Billy and Dan, Bear Haggerty Offensive. See you next week.